But people are concerned that these mRNA vaccines are getting into multiple organs, and therefore the spike proteins getting into these other organs and causing damage. Again, different spike protein, so that needs to be considered. But a lot of this data stems from some data that was generated by Pfizer and BioNTech when they were doing a bunch of safety studies looking at, you know, what happens when you inject really high concentrations of the mRNA vaccine by Pfizer into rodents. And so I think the first thing to keep in mind, and I know that at MedCram you guys have had people on like Dr. Shane Crotty, who's explained how the mRNA vaccines work, how you have, you know, the mRNA inside of a lipid nanoparticle along with some other factors like polyethylene glycol, and that is injected into the deltoid muscle tissue. And that basically, after that injection into the tissue happens, you have the lipid nanoparticle with the mRNA vaccine now getting inside of muscle cells, using your own cell machinery, the ribosome, to actually make the spike protein, which itself has been shown to peak after 24 hours. And then after 48 hours, the spike protein half-life of the protein that's made is degraded. So it's not very long lasting. The mRNA itself also has a half-life somewhere between, you know, 48 to 72 hours. And the lipid nanoparticle has this a very short, like within hours, it really only lasts long enough to protect the mRNA from being degraded. But once you actually do make the spike protein itself is expressed on the cell surface and what's called the plasma membrane of the cell. And the spike protein itself has a region on it called a transmembrane domain that sticks it. It's like an anchor. It anchors into that plasma membrane. So it is not freely floating out into your circulation. It is stuck there. And at that point, you have other immune cells that recognize this foreign protein and begin the process of, you know, making antibodies, and you have that whole, you know, immunity effect. But the concern was from this Pfizer study, where rats were given a dose that is 10 times the amount of what humans are given. So humans are given 30 micrograms of the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine for one dose. The rat was given 50 micrograms of the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine. So if you were to do the calculation for a rat equivalent dose, so if you want to give the rat what humans actually get, an equivalent dose based on their body mass, it would be more like 4.86 micrograms. So they got 50, that's essentially 10 times, okay? And this was done for a reason of, okay, what happens when we give them a huge amount of the vaccine? Well, what was found, the lipid nanoparticle that contains the mRNA was radio labeled. It's like a tag that you can visualize things. And that radio labeled tag was found in other organs. It was, you know, found in a variety of organs. Again, it was to a very small degree, but it was found in other organs. And so people got really concerned that these mRNA vaccines were traveling to other organs and causing damage. And a few things to keep in mind there. One, the dose was super high. And in fact, within the same document, the same Pfizer study, they gave a more equivalent dose to mice. In this case, they gave mice 2 micrograms of the mRNA vaccine. And that vaccine did not go to all these other organs. In fact, the only organ that was shown to have any amount of the mRNA, of this radio label tag, was the liver. And it was completely gone after 48 hours. And so, I think that's really good news, because it suggests, yeah, when you give, you know, a rat 10 times the amount of what the humans are getting, you might have some spillover. But on top of that, again, the radio labeled tag that we're looking at is the lipid nanoparticle. And if there is some spillover, you know, in the muscle tissue, what surrounds the muscle tissue is your lymphatic system, lymph, where all the immune cells are. So you essentially have your immune cells, like dendritic cells, recognizing something foreign, in this case, a radio-labeled lipid nanoparticle with some mRNA in it, and they basically chop it up, and, you know, it undergoes phagocytosis and is taken to other tissues for recycling. And so whatever we're seeing in those other organs, we don't even actually know if that's, you know, the intact mRNA vaccine lipid nanoparticle. It's probably just remnants of it because that's what your body does. So I think all of those factors in combination give some reassurance that people should not be so concerned about the spike protein from mRNA vaccines or from the Johnson & Johnson vaccine getting to other organs and causing, you know, wreaking havoc, essentially. And I will just add one more thing to that, and that is another study, and this is something that I've seen concern about on the internet. This study was done in humans. It was a very, very small sample size. It was 13 people, and they were given the Moderna mRNA vaccine. And what was found in that study is that 11 out of 13 people, the S1 subunit of the spike protein was detected in their plasma. 3 out of the 13 had the entire spike protein detectable. However, the assay that was used to detect this S1 subunit and the spike protein itself in these 13 people has a false positivity rate of 25%. That's 1 in 4 people showing they have spike protein. So the way this was another study done, and it was they took samples pre-pandemic. There should be no people with spike protein pre-pandemic, and they were showing that they had spike protein. So with a sample size of 13 and a false positivity rate of 25%, you can't make any conclusion from that small study showing, you know, that 11 out of 13 people had S1 subunit of spike protein showing up in the plasma. It just doesn't make any sense to make any strong conclusions from that. So I guess the bottom line is that, you know, as Roger mentioned, we've had over 177 million people fully vaccinated in the United States. You know, if this thing was causing severe damage in people, we would know about it. And, you know, we do know about the adverse effects that are occurring, like the myocarditis that is happening, you know, in some young people. It's still quite rare, but it does occur. And again, as Roger mentioned, it's happening sixfold higher in younger, healthy individuals than it is in people in these same individuals that are being exposed to the COVID-19 vaccines.